Okay, I think now's a good time to make a start. So I'd like to welcome everybody joining us for our webinar today on complete characterization of confectionery and coffee. I have a whole host of speakers today with me. I'm very excited to be introducing them to you. This is a joint webinar between NETZSCH and Malvern Panalytical. And we are here today to talk about everything to do with the characterization of chocolate, the gummy sweets and coffee. So just a few housekeeping rules before we start. If you've got any questions, feel free to pop them into the question box in your GoToWebinar panel you see in front of you. We'll do our very best to answer as many of those at the end. And we'll go ahead now and start. So before we start presenting on our topics, I'd like to introduce our speakers. So my name is Dr. Shona Marsh. I am the Applications and Marketing Manager for Rheology. And I am joined today by Johannes Martin. So Johannes is working as a technical sales and food process engineer for almost 10 years at NETZSCH, with demonstrated experience in developing and implementing advanced and customized process solutions for food and confectionery industry. Give us a wave, Johannes.
Yes. Hi. Hi to everybody.
Then we have also with us, joining us today, is Torsten Remler. So Torsten is one of our many applications and sales specialists for rheology product line at NETZSCH. He has studied physics at University of Leipzig and has been working rheology and supporting customers for 25 years. Torsten specializes in a vast range of application areas from foods, pharmaceuticals to adhesives, asphalts and battery slurries. And following on from Torsten, we also have Dr. Steve Ford-Smith. Sorry, technical issue there. Steve, hi Steve, give us a wave. Steve has worked for Malvern Panalytical for the last 27 years, so two more than Torsten, and he has been starting off as a laser diffraction technical specialist and now a strategic account manager for pharma and food accounts. He has a PhD in the characterization of protein polysaccharide stabilized emulsions from Nottingham University, an MSc in biomolecular technology from Leicester University, and a BSc in chemistry from Manchester University. And lastly, that brings me on to Dr. Gabrielle Kaiser. So Gabby has studied chemistry from Erlangen and started working at NETZSCH after receiving her doctorate in physical chemistry in 1991. Following her various responsibilities as head of training department, applications laboratory, technical and scientific communications department, she is now in the position of business field manager for pharma, cosmetics and food. And Gabby has been working for NETZSCH for a total of 30 years. So between us, we have many, many years of experience. So without delaying any further, I'm going to lead us straight in to the first part of our presentation, and that will be with Gabby. Oh, sorry, just one further thing, just to say, with NETZSCH, we've got presentations from both the analyzing and testing business unit, which is where Gabby's speaking from, and we also have our speaker, Johannes, from the grinding and dispersing part of our business. So just to let you know, we have two sections that are coming together. So I'm going to give the control over to Gabby. And Gabby's going to start us off with the thermal analysis of chocolate.
Thank you very much, Shona. Hello, welcome also from my side. It's a pleasure for me to present you something about thermal analysis. And especially I will talk about differential scanning calorimetry because this is the most widely used thermal analytical technique. me just see. Yeah. If we are working with DEC, DEC is the abbreviation of differential scanning calorimetry, we can try to answer questions such as, is there an energetic transformation within the investigated temperature range? Is the transition what we see exothermic or endothermic? Exothermic means generation of heat, and endothermic means consumption of heat. Exothermic processes are, for example, crystallizations or some reactions. Endothermic processes are, for example, melting processes. What is the temperature of transformation, or what is the transformation enthalpy or melting enthalpy? And melting enthalpy is also heat of fusion. This is a synonym for it. If we are looking to certain standards, for example, to ISO 11357, then we can find a definition for differential scanning calorimetry. And here it's described that DEC is a technique in which the difference between the rate of flow of heat into a specimen crucible containing the specimen and that into a reference crucible is derived as a function of temperature and or time, while the specimen and the reference are subjected to the same controlled temperature program. Most of the DEC instruments on the market are so-called heat flux DECs, and a heat flux DEC is characterized by the fact that we have sample and reference together within one furnace. A typical DEC curve, you can, one moment, let me check. Yes, you can see here on the next slide, we have displayed the DEC signal in milliwatt per milligram on the y-axis and the temperature on the x-axis. The material, what was measured here, is PET, polyethylene terephthalate. It's a semi-crystalline polymer, which is used for drinking bottles, for example. It's a semi-crystalline material, and this means it consists of amorphous parts and crystalline parts. And characteristic for the amorphous parts is a so-called glass transition, and this is a step into endothermic direction, what you see over here. And the glass transition temperature is here evaluated as the midpoint at about 75 degrees C. This is followed by a so-called cold or post-crystallization. This is an exothermal effect with a peak temperature at 137 degrees C. And finally, we see an endothermal effect with a peak temperature at 251 degrees C, which represents the melting of the material. But let's switch over now to chocolate. And one ingredient of chocolate is cocoa butter. And cocoa butter has an interesting property. Cocoa butter shows polymorphism. And polymorphism means that the material can exist in several crystal structures. And cocoa butter can crystallize in six different crystal modifications or polymorphic forms. And what we expect from chocolate, that it's that it has a glossy surface, that it has a good snap, that we have a good and smooth mouthfeel. This can be realized by the crystalline form 5, and only by this form or modification 5. All the others, they have different properties. So they have a sandy mouthfeel, for example, or they have an appearance which is not shiny or yeah, they have not a good snap or whatever. And these different crystalline modifications or polymorphic forms have different melting temperatures. And what is important during chocolate production is to temper the chocolate in a way that only the crystalline form 5 is present at the end. So the tempering process, this is a very crucial part of chocolate production. This slide presents how a DEC curve of a chocolate is looking like, for example. Here we see the DEC profile of a chocolate with a cocoa content of 60%. We see the first heating in red, the cooling in blue, and the second heating in black. And when we are looking at the red curve at first, then we can see a temperature, a peak temperature at about 33 degrees C, which is quite close to this modification 5 we are looking for, because the melting temperature of this modification 5 is about 34 degrees C. But when we cool the material down, in this case with 5 Kelvin per minute, and this is the blue curve, then we see a quite broad exothermal effect, starting at about 23 degrees C and going down below 0 degrees C. And the consequence of this cooling at 5 Kelvin per minute is the black curve during the second heating, and we see that this endothermal effect is shifted to lower temperatures. So that means that during the cooling at 5 Kelvin per minute, we have produced other modifications melting at other temperatures. Here in this slide, or in this graphic, we see the comparison of two different chocolate types with different cocoa content. A dark chocolate with a cocoa content of 70% and a whole milk chocolate with a cocoa content of 54%. And in this case, it's so that if we calculate the ratio between the cocoa content and the corresponding enthalpy, then we see that the value is more or less the same. So that means here, in this case, we really have a linear relationship between the cocoa content and the corresponding peak area. One moment. What else we can do here is we can calculate the so-called solid fat content from the melting profile. And solid fat content, or liquid fraction, means we can calculate for certain temperatures which part is already molten, so that means already in a liquid state, and which part is still solid. And if we do so for the two curves we have seen in the previous slide, for example, for a temperature of 30 degrees C, then we see that for the dark chocolate, so that means with the cocoa content of 70%, we have an already molten part of 36.8%. So that the still that this means that the still solid part is, let me calculate it, 63.2%. I hope I calculated it right. And for the whole milk chocolate, it's at 30 degrees C, almost half by half. The already molten part is 48.5%. And in my last chocolate slide, we see again this linear relationship, what I have mentioned already two slides before. The relation between the melting enthalpy and the cocoa content. And if the cocoa content goes up, then also the melting enthalpy goes up. And now I will hand on over to Johannes. He will speak about the grinding.
Yes, thank you very much, Gabi. So now we talked about the analysis, also part of the tempering process. And now I just talk a little bit about the processing. So the process equipment, and from NETZSCH we are dedicated for processing lines in terms of milling and conching. And therefore just few slides with some animations, just also that here the auditorium gets some knowledge about the processing equipment we have for that. For example, our system Rumba, it's made for chocolate and filling mass processings. And also one slide about the nut processing, which is also comes in the confectionery industry, especially more and more important. And at the end, also about coffee in the second part of these slides. So when we're talking about the chocolate processing, so it's from white milk or dark chocolate, aims you prefer here for dark chocolates, for example. You want to de-acidificate very efficiently the mass to get the sourness out of the cocoa mass, as well also for the milk chocolate or white chocolate. You're also focusing the dewatering or to demoisture the mass also with hot air and mixing processes. More and more also these processes must be adapted to sugar substitute chocolates, made from maltitol erythrit. Also you can use the systems for premium fillings like German nougat or compounds, as well also rework when you have a marzipan rework, where you also have a certain water amount inside, you want to release it. So therefore these processing lines can be used for it. Also new styles, some raw chocolate styles and so on, or using cocoa pulp, for example, as an ingredient. So very interesting approaches which comes up in the industry, and these can be handled by such systems. In order to get also an idea, not only about the analyzing, but also of the processing. So here you see a typical line and how does it work. So when we're focusing here on a milk chocolate, for example, you first have to dose the raw materials, for example, the cocoa mass, the milk powder, the sugar, as well a little bit of cocoa butter. Then you start a short mixing phase, and then you do the conching. So a heat treatment more or less of the raw materials. Afterwards, you add the residual butter, the mass becomes liquid. And as a main second step, you start the milling process with the agitator bead mills, which is also a core technology within the grinding and dispersing business unit. So maybe also to see it a little bit more precisely, here's the first starting point. And now you see here the dosing of a little bit of cocoa butter, followed by the dosing of the cocoa mass, the milk powder, and as well the crystal sugar. The resulting mixture is a very dry, sandy mass, which is very important for the following dry conching process. So now a side view of the conch after the mixing and the dosing. You add here tangentially hot air up to 80 or 90 degrees Celsius into the mass. And here you can efficiently decrease the moisture, and you also can create a certain aroma profile. So it's a question of time and temperature. So after about 2, 3, or 4 hours of processing, depending on the chocolate mass, you add the residual butter into the process, you liquefy it. And then you will see we still have coarse particles inside. There was no grinding so far. And after this liquefying step, you pump this product. So first, you pump it out from our master conch. So from the left side from the conch, you pump this coarse mass into a buffer tank, and from this buffer tank you do the transfer and you pump this mass over to the agitator bead mill, where you get the fine melting behavior and the fine milling of the mass. And after this process, the mass is ready for the tempering process, and then afterwards to be further used in the different applications you use these chocolates. So this is our system Rumba, which is mainly used for real chocolates and premium compounds. And besides that, I also like to take the chance here just for a few seconds to talk about some similar installations in this field. For example, the nut processing, if it's almond paste processing, for example, for almond milk, or some other tahini production, for example, made of roasted sesame seeds. Then we also have systems available consisting of a pre-grinding and a fine grinding system. The fine grinding is as well the same or similar as for the chocolate. And here you can also create different pastes, always related with the desired end fineness. So here some on-site videos from a processing line. For example, here, this is an example for almonds. You put in blanched or roasted almonds, then you have the pre-grinding section, then the product gets transferred into our pump, also from our sister company, the NETZSCH pumps. And from this pump, the coarse paste gets pumped over to the fine mill, to the type master refiner, where we create the fine paste which you see here, which flows into the bucket. So these are typical examples for our machineries for the confectionery industry in terms of chocolate and nut pastes. So also we have different pilot plants worldwide. So for example, for Germany, in terms of dry milling, we have it in Hanau near Frankfurt. For homogenization, we have it in Bremen in the north, or for example, in Selb, we have the white lip for all the fat-based masses, like for chocolate, fat-based filling masses, and nut paste. Okay, this is a short overview of the applications in terms of confectionery from our grinding and dispersing business unit. And now I also would like to take over to my next colleague.
Thank you. Right, okay, I'll give you a quick guide to the particle sizing of chocolate. Okay, right, so there's a variety of different tools that we at Malvern Panalytical employ within the chocolate industry. We're mainly going to be talking about particle sizing for the next 5 minutes or so, which is the master sizer which you see at the top, which is generally used in production control. In the manufacturing process at this point, and you're optimizing the particle size. The grinding of chocolate is a very expensive process because increasing the surface area means more cocoa butter to coat it, and that costs quite a bit of money. So if you undermill, you can have a significant extra cost in energy. And obviously energy costs have massively increased recently. So it's even more important to get the particle size small enough, but not too small. You've got to make it small enough because if it's too big, it tastes greasy on the mouth, and we don't feel it's a particularly pleasant mouthfeel as consumers. I'll talk more about that in a couple of minutes. The formulation we'll talk more about a little bit later when we talk into the gummy sweets, but it gets used really for anything that's an emulsion. I'm looking at the stability, the particle charge on the particles, and the particle size if the drops are particularly small. Gabby talked about the crystalline forms. One way you can actually look at that is using X-ray diffraction. Looks at the phase behavior of the cocoa butter. And chocolate is an extremely good source of iron. Some people say it's actually more iron than eating a steak. For looking at the amount of iron in there, you could use XOF. So why do we want to measure chocolate's particle size? Well, I started to allude to that on a couple of minutes ago. Well, it's mainly down, a lot of it's down to mouthfeel. Coarser particle size makes the product feel gritty and unpleasant or greasy. A decreased particle size may take longer to melt in the mouth. I mean, it feels odd because it's not what you're used to. Larger particle size can also lead to a slower flavor release, so it may taste different and a bit strange. The fat content, a finer particle size, this is what I was saying, needs additional more cocoa butter to disperse the cocoa solids. Cocoa butter is the most expensive component, and so it can cost significantly extra to produce your chocolate. Production cost, I talked about this as well, may lead to a finer size, increased energy usage, and energy bills are obviously in everyone's minds at the moment. Raw material costs, may lead to a finer size, increases cocoa butter costs. That's a big part of the cost of a chocolate. Processability and rheology, increased polydispersity, the width of the size distribution, leads to an increased packing fraction, which can change the suspension rheology. And this is important in developing low-fat chocolate, because the chocolate itself is a mix of cocoa butter, vegetable oil, or milk, depending on what your formulation you're using. Emulsifiers, often lecithin, cocoa solids, and sugar. So we talked about differences in particle size. I skipped ahead of the slide. I'll get back. So it's about 30, 32 microns. It changes a little bit from company to company, but it's about, it should be 30 microns, not 30 millimeters, but gritty chocolate containing particles greater than 30 microns in size is considered to be poor quality. But if we have too many fine particles produced during milling, we get problems with processing and controlling the chocolate base behavior. If we overmill, we increase the production costs. Cocoa butter did, and this is numbers I looked at a couple of years ago, was up to $4,000 per ton. Things are likely to have got significantly higher since. And this small difference in particle size you see here, but both of which would pass specification if your specification is D90s of about 30 micron. One's got 28 micron D90, one's got 24 micron D90. The rest of the distribution is the same, apart from that top at that top tail. That difference could cost you up to $2.8 million per year. They're both acceptable products, but one's a bit too fine, and that being a little bit too fine, increase your cocoa butter costs, and that is an enormous extra amount of money that you have to spend, because the green chocolate PSD is good enough. The particle size also changes depending on where in the world you're buying your chocolate. American chocolate is generally a little bit coarser than UK chocolate. It's just what people are used to. And dark chocolate, milk chocolate, and white chocolate have very different particle size distributions. They've got different amounts of cocoa solids and different amounts of sugar. So the PSDs are quite different. So we see these clear differences in the shape of the particle distribution between the three types of chocolate. But we see commonality too. We see a mode of large particles at about 30 microns and a mode of smaller particles at about 5 microns. The 30 micron mode is less present in dark chocolate. You see it more as a slight shoulder. And these proportions and ratios of the different peaks is really related to the presence proportion of different ingredients. The large mode is definitely down to sugar, and you see for the increasing sugar content from dark to milk to white chocolate, there's less large particles in dark chocolate. So it's conceived to be by quite often by people having a smoother, more luxurious texture, because there's less gritty particles in there. Okay. Over to Torsten.
Thank you, Stephen, and hello, everyone. Welcome also from my side. Let's talk about rheology of chocolate now, how chocolate flows. But not only that, we can also have a look on the structural mechanical properties of chocolate when it turns into a solid. So now, what kind of instruments do we have available to measure rheological properties? We have our rotational rheometer, the Kinexus. This is basically an instrument which covers the low forces, low speed range when the sample flows under very delicate small forces, and can also do these structural analysis, which are deeply related to the viscoelastic nature of chocolate, yeah, being a solid and a liquid at the same time. When it turns into processing, yeah, into mixing, like we have heard from Johannes in his talk, then a capillary rheometer is most suitable because it can cover the high shears, the high forces or pressures when the chocolate flows at high speeds. And so both instruments are absolute methods. So we get absolute viscometry data in the overlapping region, viscosity values, the resistance against the flow must be equal. Now, many people think that viscosity is just a number. And if we look on a typical viscosity function, we see from a first view that this is not the case, because if we increase the speed at which the chocolate flows, then we will see a change in its viscosity, in the resistance against the flow. And typically, also for other food samples, yeah, we will see a relatively large, high viscosity at low shear rates. The shear rate in rheology is the ratio between the speed of the flow parallel to the surface in relation to the geometry in which the sample flows. And this high viscosity at low shear rates is then turning into relatively low values at higher speeds, higher shear rates. So we call this behavior shear thinning. The sample gets lower in viscosity when the speed of the flow is increased. So you can have two different kinds of chocolate, and if you measure just at one speed, at one shear rate, they can have the same viscosity. But you see from these curves here that there are huge differences in the low shear and in the high shear region. And now, if you take a simple viscometer, which measures usually in the mid shear rate region, you cover maybe exactly that region where there are no much difference between those two types. But it depends on the process. We need to calculate typical shear rates or also shear stresses, tangential forces divided by the surface area. And then we will find out, for instance, what the typical shear rates in Johannes' mixing process were, or if you just pour a chocolate onto such a chocolate bar and the gravitational stress is acting, that is then at much lower shear rates and describes how the chocolate is leveling. You can also be interested in the storage or shelf life of suspensions, like a salad dressing, for instance. That can be at even lower shear rates. But if you go into the processing more, then maybe you extrude something, an ice cream, for instance, or you pump your chocolate. Yeah, those are typically even higher shear rates. So therefore, it's always good to know at which conditions the sample is being processed and what happens after the processing to relate the viscosity function to the real process. And now we have these two types of instruments, the rotational rheometer and the capillary rheometer. You see, it covers a very wide shear rate range, but the rotational rheometer, the Kinexus, is more dedicated for the low shears, the capillary rheometer more dedicated for the high shears. So we would say process relevant flow properties are best covered with the capillary, and structural information, structural properties and low shear behavior best covered with the rotational rheometer. So rheology is the science of deformation and flow when outer forces are acting on our sample. So we can start with really, really small forces and study the structural mechanical properties, the deformation behavior at small scale. This is related to the viscoelastic behavior, the mixture of solid and liquid-like behavior in the structure itself when no flow takes place. And typically, this will be done on the rotational rheometer in a mode of operation which we call oscillatory shear. So we apply small sinusoidal shear waves to the sample without breaking the structure, and then analyzing the amount of energy which is stored and the amount of energy which is dissipated into heat. And this gives us the information about the viscoelasticity. But we can break the structure by even larger strains and deformations, or even larger forces applied to the sample, and then we get into the flow, and then of course the resistance against the flow, the viscosity, is important factor. And we have seen that this is a function depending on the shear rate and the shear stress, as well as the temperature, of course, and time can also play important role. So we can answer then questions how viscous the sample is under certain processes like pumping, yeah, how much pressure you need to apply to pump a certain volume flux, volume of chocolate per time through a pipe, for instance. Now, here you see a typical result of a steady state shear viscosity function. Steady state means we are waiting for each shear rate that the chocolate gets into time independent flow. And then we go step by step each shear rate and measure the resistance against the flow, the shear viscosity. And we have compared here dark chocolate, milk chocolate, and white chocolate. White chocolate has by far the highest viscosity of all three chocolate types. So it is also known to be most difficult to be processed. It has the highest yield stress. This is the critical force you need to break the structure to get the chocolate into the flow. And that will be relevant, for instance, if you pour a liquid chocolate on top of a cake, for instance, and then it levels, and the yield stress prevents further leveling, for instance. So you see, those curve for the white chocolate is showing the shear thinning behavior. So we cannot describe the viscosity with a single number. We take model parameters. There are various flow models available for chocolate, which has a yield stress, such as the Herschel-Balcke model or the Casson model. And we take these parameters of the model to describe the complete flow behavior. And you have seen here, if we compare the yield stress of the white chocolate with the milk and dark chocolate, they have nearly the same yield stress, dark and white, but dark and milk, and the white chocolate has a much stronger structure at rest. And the viscosity differs, as we said, white chocolate has the highest, and milk and dark nearly similar. So this is related to, from one side, the processing behavior, and from other side, after you process the chocolate, the structural recovery at rest, creating that yield stress. But those numbers depend on temperature. Temperature is another parameter affecting viscosity. So therefore, customers in the chocolate industry or in research, they do temperature-dependent viscosity measurements. Here you see the temperature-dependent viscosity function of a chocolate versus temperature. You see that the viscosity is dropping. You see when you go downwards in temperature, when you cool down from a liquid state to a more solid state, there are also transient effects. So the structure is being destroyed. Yeah? The yield stress needs to be overcome before the sample gets into the flow and getting into a time-independent flow condition. That's what we call thixotropy. And a typical behavior is that the viscosity is increasing with decreasing temperature, but we cannot change two parameters at the same time. So therefore, we measure here typically at a fixed shear rate, which is typical for the given process, at which you want to know something about the temperature dependency. And then we vary the temperature with a certain heating or cooling rate. But if you want to see the full flow curve, the full viscosity curve for each temperature, then we do a temperature table. So we get the sample isothermal, wait for thermal equilibrium, and then do the viscosity function at each single discrete temperature. You might say, okay, viscosity of chocolate is one side, but what about the final product? Yeah, like a chocolate bar. Yeah, so how does it feel if you take it from the fridge and bite on it? Yeah, we can do solids testing on the Kinexus rotational rheometer. We can check, for instance, the texture. We can take two prisms and put a chocolate bar on it. And on top, we apply another prism, which we use as a cutting edge, if you want. We drive down with the prism in the middle to the chocolate bar, which is then placed on these two outer prisms you see here in the picture. And we just apply a normal force perpendicular to the surface. Effectively, this is a three-point bending test for texture analysis of a chocolate bar. In this chart, you see in blue, we drive down the prism, which bends the sample, and we create an increasing force. That's clear. Yeah, we bend the sample, the force rises, and now at a certain critical force, the chocolate bar breaks. Yeah, that's what you need to apply with your teeth to cut the chocolate bar. And if you take the chocolate bar from the fridge at a lower temperature, you see here you need much higher force to break it than if you would store it at ambient temperature. So those are solid tests. It has nothing to do with viscosity, with flow, but gives you mechanical informations, in this case on the mouthfeel when you eat such a chocolate bar. The Kinexus is capable of applying actual forces perpendicular to the surface of a sample and tangential forces parallel to the sample. Yeah, we can squeeze the sample. At the same time, we can shear it. Yeah, so this we can do with a very high speed in axial direction with very high data rates. So to mimic certain processes in food industry, such as chewing. Yeah, if you have a chocolate in your mouth, how does it feel? What is the impact of temperature in your mouth on the viscosity, but on the other side also on the mouth feel? So we call it dual action, Kinexus dual action, this combination of actual and shear forces at the same time, which happens in your mouth when you chew something. And a simple experiment would be you place a piece of chocolate onto a lower plate of the Kinexus rotational rheometer. You apply a axial force with an upper plate onto the surface of the chocolate, and then you heat up. Yeah? You heat up the chocolate and look what the mechanical behavior, the squeeze flow, stiffness of the sample will be. And the software is very flexible in that sense. You can also apply at the same time oscillatory shear if you wish, or only the actual force, which is mimicking when you press together your teeth. And so when you take a simple temperature ramp from starting to end temperature while you have applied a certain normal force, giving here in red, this was 1 newton, actual force on this piece of chocolate, we can monitor the change in the gap. We can, if you want, check the softening point of a dark chocolate and a milk chocolate. And you see here that the dark chocolate melts at much lower temperature than the milk chocolate. So this has, of course, an impact on the mouthfeel. And it will be also depending on the actual force which you apply. So you can do the same study with larger or smaller actual forces to mimic this mouthfeel. Yeah, those were just some examples what can be done with chocolate in rheology. And maybe it's a good time now to test this mouthfeel of a real chocolate sample. So I will also take one, and I'm sure Shauna will help us getting another chocolate. I will hand over to the next speaker then.
Which I think is me again, to just quickly guide you through your chocolate tasting. Yep. Hopefully you've got a couple of different types of chocolate. I've got something that is milk chocolate that describes itself as having a small particle size, and a white chocolate. So if anyone wants to taste that chocolate, and think about it, because Shona is going to ask, in a poll, some questions about your chocolate. So just try and put the mouthfeel and think about what your sensory perceptions are. Does it taste smooth? Does it taste gritty? What's the snap like? These are things to kind of think about now, and then we'll ask you some kind of some questions about this later on.
So I can guide you to the poll now if you want to. If you want to consider this and answer these questions now in the poll in your
in your GoToWebinar panel, there should just be four simple questions for you to consider the two different chocolates if you're trying them. Unfortunately, in the UK, I don't know about the rest of the world, we've got a bit of a heat wave. So it might be that you've not got much of a snap on your chocolate anyway. I don't know how you are, how it is with you, Steve.
Mine's more kind of slightly soggy, especially as I've been out of the office for a couple of days and got this from a garage on Tuesday. So it's been hanging around in my bag for a couple of days. So it's even worse.
Well, mine are definitely partially melted. Because it's so hot, so there's no snap there. But if anybody wants to eat chocolate while we talk about the rest of the webinar, and then feel free to fill out the poll as we go, and we can have a look at the results at the end. So I think, Steve, if you haven't got your mouth full of chocolate, then you can go on to the next slide. I think that's also yours.
We can. There we go, which is phase and elemental analysis. There we go. Yes, so we alluded to the crystalline state. I just had anyone to do that. I think I've got a bit of lag here, so I managed to jump through a couple of slides. I need to go back. There we go. Oh, yes, I jumped through. Now I've gone back. Yeah, too far. No, it's just, there we go. By clicking it once, there's a bit of a lag, so you press it twice and then it jumps you through it. Here we go. Yeah, there is definitely quite a considerable lag. Using XRD can allow you to improve your production consistency and understand the very complex process of tempering, which is kind of like a lot of where the magic happens in chocolate. And to really look at phase changes during storage. I mean, a lot of you will be familiar with chocolate when you get the kind of blooming, which is a phase change in the chocolate. When you pick up it's often boxes of chocolate more than a bar itself, but you open a box of chocolates at Christmas or something and you see this kind of blooming, this kind of very white thing there. It's not really a poor quality, it's just been there's been some temperature changes during storage and it's caused the phase change of the chocolate to shift, and so you see this bloom. And you can do this by looking at the difference between reflection and transmission geometry using XRD. And you can predict this and try and guard against it, but sometimes it's not necessarily possible. But you can understand your product better. And we talked about X-ray fluorescence. Here is where, obviously the chocolate company is buying their cocoa from different sources. There's a lot of very, very expensive such chocolates are going to the single estate cocoa beans, you know, but like coffee, you may be paying to have the material coming from certain sources. Are you getting what you're paying for? Because looking at things like X-ray fluorescence will tell you the kind of elemental signature of your cocoa. And it will, you'll be able to look there, you'll be able to see exactly what's happening and whether you have the right elemental signature that you're expecting. So here you can see you've got a fair amount of iron, which you've got in here. You've got some copper, you've got some zinc, and you've got some potassium. So you can see what your elemental signature you're expecting, and is that consistent with what you normally get? So you can use it as kind of good zinc UC, check you've got any contamination, and you are buying what you are supposed to be buying and no one's trying to pull a fast one, and you're buying something you shouldn't be. Okay, right, we're now going to go on to gummy sweets.
We are going to do a really quick discussion on gummy sweets, and I'm conscious of time, so then we'll finish off with coffee. So just to briefly go over some of the topics regarding the gummy suits, we have Gabby going to talk to us about thermal analysis and DMA, and then Steve's going to do a little bit on XRF. So I will just hand over to Gabby, and Gabby, please take it away.
Oh, welcome back. Yeah, if we are looking on gummy sweets, then we can see, or we can feel that they are quite flexible, and sometimes they are also a little bit sticky. And this is typical for amorphous materials. And if you remember the DSC curve of the PET, what you have seen, the characteristic effect for amorphous materials is the glass transition step. And here you can see a glass transition step, a typical DSC curve for a gummy bear or a gummy sweet during heating at 10 Kelvin per minute. And the evaluated temperature here for characterizing the glass transition temperature is the mid temperature here at minus 28 degrees C. This means that above this temperature range, the material, in this case the gummy sweet, is a rubber-like or has a rubber-like behavior. Below the glass transition step, it's rigid and hard and stiff. This glass transition is sensitive to the environmental conditions. So here, this graphic, so the minus 28 degrees C are typical in this case for a fresh gummy sweet. So that means taken directly out of the package. But if we bring it in contact with some water, then we see a shift of this glass transition effect to lower values. So water acts as a plasticizer and shifts the glass transition to lower temperatures. In this case, the mid-temperature moves from minus 28 degrees C to minus 52 degrees C. And if we have, on the other hand, dry conditions, then we have also a shift, but in the opposite direction. And this can be seen here on this slide. If we store the gummy sweet 12 hours in the lab environment, and the lab environment was quite dry, then we see a shift upwards from minus 28 degrees C to minus 12 degrees C. However, gummy sweets can not only be measured by using DC, they can also be measured by using DMA, for example. And DMA stands for dynamic mechanical analysis. And dynamic mechanical analysis is a method where we can get some information about the mechanical behavior of materials. So we can study the viscoelastic behavior of materials. And what we see here on this slide is a comparison between two types of gummy sweets, a gelatin-based gummy sweet. The curves for the gelatin-based gummy sweets are in red, and some region gummy sweets, so that means without any gelatin inside, and they are painted in green. And what you see in the graphic is the E modulus, and we see the so-called tangent delta, the loss factor. The E modulus goes down with increasing temperature, and when we are looking at temperatures around 30 degrees C, for example, then we see that the green curve is a little bit positioned above the red curve. And this means that the region gummy sweet is a little bit stiffer at that temperature than the gelatin-based gummy sweet. On the other hand, DMA is also a method where we can, which we can use to determine glass transition temperatures. But what you have already seen in the DSC curve is that the glass transition is covering a temperature range. And the mid temperature, what was evaluated in the DSC curve, was just 1 point out of this range. And in DMA and dynamic mechanical analysis, we have different possibilities of evaluating different curves for this glass transition determination. One possibility is to use the tension delta curve, the loss factor curve for determining the glass transition. And here we are looking for the peak temperature. And if we do so, then we see that we have also here a difference between the region gummy sweet and the gelatin-based gummy sweet. The gelatin-based gummy sweet has a peak temperature of the 10 delta curve at about minus 0.4 degrees C, so that means around zero. And the peak temperature of the region gummy sweet is shifted to 11.6 degrees C. Yeah, and now I will hand over to Steve again.
Thank you, Gabby. I'm going to keep my camera off for the moment because the audio is breaking up a little bit and I want to preserve what bandwidth I've actually got. Oh, right, so what we is you can see here. Yeah, the, here's a, was an interesting kind of story. We'll go back to the, which shows you how much money was in kind of in chocolate. We can, you can see kind of here the amount of that £100,000 worth of fake chocolate was seized, and this was about a month ago on Oxford Street. And this is which was apparently down as Wonka bars. Don't think he had any golden tickets in them, but it was a case of like, but a lot of it was along Oxford Street with some of the stores there. They weren't the real thing, and so yeah, be careful when you're buying. And this goes for cosmetics and things like chocolate. But from certain stores, if it looks too cheap to be true, it probably is, and you don't really know what's in there. As I say, if you've been, and as it says in the Food Standards Agency here, if you bought these knockoff bars, do not eat them. You've no idea of the food safety in here. They're not the real thing, and they could well have significantly unsafe levels of contaminants in them. And unsafe levels of contaminants. Here we are. This, obviously, you can use elemental analysis as on gummy sweets as well, and you can actually see what are the levels of elements actually kind of in there. Here we can detect things like chromium, iron, copper, and zinc, and obviously they should meet food regulations. And if they're outside that, they could be causing you harm. So it's always best to buy. It might be more expensive, and everyone's trying to save money these days, but buy from safe sources. And something from a open air market may not be the real thing. It might be, but if it looks too good to be true, it probably is. Obviously, gummy sweets themselves, they would be rather disgusting if they were just gummy. They've actually got flavors in them. We have like strawberry flavor or lemon flavor or orange flavor. So it's got a flavor emulsion in there. Flavor emulsions themselves, they're emulsions. And as a colloid scientist, I'm particularly interested in emulsions, and I'm interested in zeta potential. That's the charge on the particles. And that's something else we can measure here. So we can predict the stability of the flavorings we actually use and check if they're gonna be unstable or not, because you generally don't want large particles. So we can help in formulation development. And obviously they also contain sugar, and we can measure different grades of sugar. The particle size is important. Here we see the particle size of icing sugar, caster sugar, and granulated sugar, which are very different. So you can optimize that accordingly. And then finally, we're going to talk about coffee. Such we start to talk about the grinding of coffee and then finish with the talking about the particle size. Right, I think I'm Shona, was I handing over to someone else now or do I go through?
No, yep, I can. Oh, I can go. It's got control.
Fine, yep.
Yeah, I'm back in the session and I think we are a little bit overdue, so also I hear. Yeah, next to the chocolate application I talked to you previously. So here we have just an example also from the grinding dispersing side, so from the prosic technology of coffee. Yeah, when it's also about capsuled coffee and when it's about flavor enhancement in such dry coffee mixtures. So here we have also, for example, an application which is called jet milling of coffee, and this is done, as you see here, an example with a fluidized bed jet mill. As coffee has also a certain fat level, it's not that easy just to grind coffee to this fineness to get the flavor, the full flavor out. So the finer, the more flavor you get. And therefore, for such a process, you normally mix roast and ground coffee, and you mix it with coffee extract powder, so with instant coffee, roughly 50-50%. And this mixture you transfer into a jet mill, and then you get here, for example, when you start with around 500 microns particle size inlet, then you normally target about 20 till 40 microns as an end fineness in the 90 value. So I'm like to jump to the next slide. Maybe Shona, you can just, okay. Here's also a short example how such mill works. And now I hope this video starts. So quite simple example. So this is more or less a mill where you see from the left side the raw material mixture comes to the bottom of this mill, and then we have a ring channel with a compressed air up to 7 bars, and this accelerates the particles in the lower part of the mill, and due to impact grinding and autogene grinding of particle to particles, the coffee gets ground and the finest particles will leave from the top part of this vessel via a dynamic classifier. So this is a dry milling process based on jet acceleration of the particles to get these fine particles for full flavor release of coffee, for example, in capsuled coffee, for example. Here we have also possibilities to test when it's of interest, this application. And so far, this is my part from the grinding dispersing, what is coffee related, and also then I handle further to Steve, I think.
Thank you. Right, and I will bring you home, I think, as we start to finish.
All right. Thanks so far from my side.
Thank you. I need to press advance. And obviously the particle size you're actually getting there's many different types of coffee, for those of you aware, or especially if you go into somewhere like Starbucks. And obviously there's different types of roast, but there's also very much different types of size, and the product can change very drastically depending on how fine the coffee is ground. And if you're making or want coffee for a drip filter maker, you want a kind of medium grind. Cone filters, you want something that's got a finer grind. French presses or plunger pots or percolators, you generally want coarse coffee, and espresso is generally finer. So generally, fine particles, you get bitter taste. Coarse particle sizes are generally smoother. So for filter coffees, are generally bigger, so we get a smooth bend, maybe slightly smaller. And espresso bones have generally got the finest particle size of all. And they're generally quite short and intense. Or Turkish coffee. Turkish coffee is extremely small, but that's why it forms a kind of powder as such. It's very much kind of unlike espresso. It's almost kind of like it's so small it almost aggregates because it can be quite kind of crunchy. It's quite strange stuff. But no, so your particle size of coffee will change drastically depending on that. The taste will change drastically depending on the size. So controlling the PSD is extremely important. But things like roasting times also play a big important part in the flavor profile. Okay, I think we are coming through to the end. Well, here we see the last slide. We can see here an electric grinder and how we use the muscle size of 3000 to check the particle size, and a different turn of the grinder kind of in here will give you a completely different particle size. So those of you who've got a coffee machine and can control the grind size can control the strength of your coffee. So whacking it up all the way gives you a very fine particle size, and going the other way gives you a very coarse particle size. So you can change the strength of the coffee depending on the gap in your coffee mill. Particle size decreases as the gap size is reduced. So if you've got the control, you can have a play with it and see what kind of coffee tastes right for you. Okay, and I'll bring it up to Shona, I think, to summarize.
Okay, thank you so much, everyone. We have gone over by a few minutes. Steve, are you able to answer two questions, or
can we do that now? Almost kind of now. Yes. I've really got to go to run for a taxi.
Okay, so we're just summarizing, and just a couple of questions for Steve. What is the minimum D90 of the fines for chocolate that you can measure?
I mean, people tend to for the D90, they tend to often set it around 30 to 32 microns is normally what they go. That you can obviously be smaller, and some products, if they are going for a smooth chocolate, can be smaller, but that will obviously increase the production costs because you need more cocoa butter to coat. So certain brands that describe themselves as being smooth do have a smaller particle size, and they may be down to about 20, 27, 28 microns or so, D90.
Great. And then lastly, just before you go, what dispersant do you use to measure particle size distribution for chocolate components, such as cocoa?
Lots of people
butter?
Use different things. It's changed a little bit over the years. Some people use sunflower oil. And then Isopar G was often quite used. And then people used a synthetic silicon oil called volatile 844 was very popular. But now a lot of people use a kind of artificial food oil called Acamed R. And that's pretty much most of the leading companies tend to do that. There's the odd one that uses something quite esoteric or special, but most people use Acamed R, but some people will still use things like sunflower oil.
Okay, thank you very much, Steve. We are slightly over for questions, so if there's any more, I will let you know, and I will let you get away.
Thank you, Shona.
No problem. So just to summarize the presentation for everybody, we have spoken today about the characterization of chocolate. We've looked at the influence of particle size, so laser diffraction on mouthfeel and viscosity. Torsten guided us through all about viscosity measurements of chocolate. And then Gabby spoke to us a little bit about the thermal analysis and DSE measurements of chocolate and solid fat content. And then Johannes kindly spoke to us about processing of chocolate masses and also nut pastes. And then we touched very briefly on gummy sweets and looked at the influence of storage conditions with thermal analysis. We looked at food additives with XRF laser diffraction, and also looking at the properties of the gummy sweets with DMA. And finally, we just touched on coffee, so looking at the grinding of coffee and how to measure particle size and different coffee grades. I have also just put out the chocolate poll to everybody for tasting the chocolate. So we have some of those results coming in. We've got 73% saying that the premium chocolate gave more satisfying snap. And then if I just put out another poll, then feel free to answer that question. And I, whilst that's going on, I'm just going to quickly ask Torsten, if you're available.
Yes, I am.
What recommended geometries or measuring systems would you use for measuring chocolate in the molten stage?
There is one dedicated geometry. This is called a cup and bob geometry. You have a fixed outer cup and a rotating inner bob. This is a standard geometry according to ISO 32.19, and it gives you absolute shear viscosity data. So we would recommend, the gap size is quite high, so we have no issues with maximum particle size compared to a cone plate geometry. So therefore, the typical geometry is cup and bob. And another advantage for quality control is that there are no such high trimming impact, loading impact, like for cone plate, plate. So people like to use it because of its robustness in terms of the sample volume which you fill into the cup and bob. The disadvantage is you need quite large volumes in the range of 10 to 18 milliliter. Takes quite long to get into thermal equilibrium, but the robustness in the accuracy of the data is convincing, especially for quality control.
Thank you very much. Okay, well, that brings us to the end of the presentation. So for those of you who are interested in our poll results, 63% actually said that the value chocolate melted faster in their mouth. We have 68% say that the premium chocolate felt smoother in their mouth, and 55% said that the chocolate appeared more glossy. So hopefully the temperature, wherever you are in the world, hasn't affected your chocolate too much. I know some people like to store them in the fridge, but I'd just like to thank all of our speakers. I know some of them have had to rush away because of time, but if we've got any more questions, we'll pass those on to our speakers. So thank you so much for attending, and we hope to see you at our next webinar. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.